Tonight, the race for a vaccine. Three of the world's leading candidates reporting positive early trial results. And the major headline coming from the University of Oxford, which found its vaccine is safe so far and induces an immune response. Out front now, Professor Adrian Hill, one of the lead researchers working on the vaccine at Oxford. Professor, thank you so much for being here. I appreciate your time. Lay out for us the promising signs that you're seeing with your vaccine.
What we've reported today in The Lancet is a new data set on the phase one trial of our vaccine, meaning just over 1,000 people. And firstly, the safety data looks very reassuring in all of those individuals. No serious adverse events, nothing of significant concern. And then when we look at the immune responses, they are present in everybody. We see good neutralizing antibodies. These are the ones that we are looking for that should inhibit the infection of the virus into cells. And in addition, we see the other arm of the immune system, the cellular arm, usually called T cells, which are there in large numbers as well, even after a single dose of the vaccine. So really results at the high end of our expectations. So we are now moving forward. We vaccinated around about 10,000 people in trials so far, and we are following those for efficacy to see if the vaccine really works.
So now, right, so now you charge into phase three. You've got trials in the UK, Brazil, and South Africa that are underway. Can you say how much closer you are now to a final vaccine?
Well, I should add that the largest trial should start soon, and that is actually in the US.
Right.
So we're hoping that will be underway in the next 2 or 3 weeks. How close we are depends, of course, on the incidence of infection in the trial population. That's relatively low in the UK, but high in South Africa and high in Brazil. And we anticipate that in some of the states that we work in the US, the infection rates will be high as well. So it's very difficult to call. Could be September, could be October. Nobody really knows, and we're blinded to the data as it comes in.
That's right.
But you know, we're still hoping for this year. Absolutely.
Still hoping for this year. The big unknown is how strong of the immunity is and how long it lasts. When do you think you will have an answer to that with your vaccine?
Yeah, those two questions, whether the immune response is strong enough to protect people with high efficacy is really the key question. In terms of how long it will last, we're less concerned about that. We've used this vaccine type before. Immunity is durable, certainly for a year, probably for longer than that. So that's much less of a risk. The real question that nobody can answer is, are the immune responses that we and some other groups are seeing actually strong enough, potent enough to stop this infection happening and to protect people? Based on what we've seen in animal data, the answer is probably yes, but humans could be different.
The record-breaking pace at which you and other developers are working is so comforting to so many, as a vaccine is really the only way out of this global crisis. But what do you say, Professor, to people who are concerned that it's all moving too fast, so much faster than other vaccine development has gone in the past, that speed could compromise safety? What do you say to that?
Well, I think we can reassure those people along these lines. We're not actually doing anything different to what we would traditionally do in vaccine development. Yes, we're moving faster, but all the checks and balances in the system are being observed, a stringent regulatory review. We have data safety monitoring committees. Of course, everything goes through an ethical committee. And the quality of the vaccine that we're using is what we would normally use in any development program. And in fact, we're learning a lot more about scaling up this vaccine now that we have to make hundreds of millions of doses. So there aren't any shortcuts. We're observing all the safety requirements, but we're doing that with less gap in between all of the stages. So we're getting very rapid response from the regulators, decisions often the same day, an interactive process. And this is the way that all vaccines could be developed if there were sufficient resource and determination in the system to develop other vaccines in the same at the same speed.
Could antibodies be the key? They are a protein that your body produces to fight off bacteria, parasites, and viruses like COVID. They are not only vital for vaccine development, but also in treatment. Dr. Sanjay Gupta is out front.
If there's one thing most humans on the planet want right now, it's antibodies. Your body can produce them if you're infected. A vaccine can also provide you with them. But there is another way. It's called antibody therapy. That means taking the antibodies from the blood of someone who's already been infected and recovered from COVID-19.
We've used it for rabies for hundreds of years. More recent history in the Ebola outbreak in West Africa, people tried something called convalescent plasma.
Dr. Marshall Lyon is an infectious disease physician at Emory University. He also treated some of the first Ebola patients in the United States.
And so plasma is the part of the blood which contains all of these antibodies.
Within the plasma, you are likely to find antibodies which specifically attach to this part of the virus. It's called the spike protein, and it's the key to entering human cells.
If an antibody binds this little finger part, that's obviously going to block the attachment to the cell. That will neutralize the virus.
Dr. Barney Graham is deputy director of the Vaccine Research Center at the National Institutes of Health.
There's other spots that you can bind the protein that disrupts its function.
What he is describing are called neutralizing antibodies. They work to block the virus from actually infecting cells in our body.
Having an antibody or the plasma from convalescent patients allows you to accomplish, at least temporarily, what we're trying to accomplish with the vaccine. So you can just give the antibody. We call it passive immunization. Then you can give the antibody ahead of time and create temporary immunity.
Taking antibodies in that plasma and giving that to somebody, either to help protect them against becoming infected or even possibly as a treatment. How effective should that type of antibody therapy be, convalescent plasma?
I think it's very important that these serum therapies and plasma therapies and even hyperimmunoglobulin therapies are tested both as treatment for serious disease, but maybe also intervention in the early phase of infection so that it doesn't progress to serious disease.
The hope is that these antibodies can do a preemptive strike, preventing more serious disease from developing in someone who's infected, or maybe even blocking infection altogether in people who are at high risk, like healthcare workers. Some have even called it a bridge to the vaccine. Companies like Eli Lilly and Regeneron are now trialing therapies using neutralizing antibodies found in recovered patients, but then manufactured in the lab. They're known as monoclonal antibody therapies.
To be able to put them to good use in therapy or prevention is really an exciting new technology.
But there is an issue. Some recent research has found that COVID-19 antibodies may wane after several weeks, and it was those who are sickest who tend to produce the most antibodies. And keep in mind, the majority of people with COVID experience just mild symptoms.
How does that compare to how long the antibody should last from a vaccine?
For antibodies, the typical half-life of an antibody in humans is around 3 to 4 weeks. And so those antibodies, if given at a high dose, could last for a couple of months.
These are all considerations in developing a COVID-19 treatment, as well as a vaccine.
Sanjay is back with me now. Sanjay, this is so fascinating and important, but this, that bit on how concerning is it what we're seeing with this waning antibody response? What does it really mean?
Yeah, I think it's a concern, and I think that the vaccinologists, people who are working on this, are really trying to address this. I watched your interview with Dr. Adrian Hill, who says with his type of vaccine platform, the antibody should last a long time. But one other thing I'll stick in your head, Kate, it's the antibodies which people are measuring, but we should also be looking at what is known as T cells. And T cells, again, something Professor Hill mentioned, but T cells are sort of the core component of this immune response. So even if you have antibodies that have waned over time, if you have still T cells, the T cells can quickly ramp up the immune sort of system in response to a virus. So you've got to look at both, and it looks like the T cell reactivity is still there and prominent. So that's going to be helpful.
Learning so much, but still so far to go. It's great. Thank you, Sanjay.